I'm enjoying my extensions. Salbala to everybody. Super, super hello to Mona. Oh, Rushad is in the room. Thank you, Rushad, for all the lovely photographs you have sent me from Iceland. Malika, my angel. You are my angel, my sweetheart. Suchita, Indira, Shweta, Hina, Sonia. Woohoo! So nice to see so many familiar faces. Hello, 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 everybody. Oh, I love you too. Fabulous. All right. So how many of you are seeing me this coming weekend? Not this coming weekend, the next weekend, the 26th, 27th, 28th. Anybody here enrolled into Love Bubble? I want to know, because I want to speak a little bit more about Love Bubble. If you haven't yet looked at the 2 days of relationship session that I may be taking the first time and the last time, I'd love for you to show up, because can I tell you something? This is going to be mind-blowing. Today onwards, the newspaper ads have started. From tomorrow, there's some more promotion going to start. But I want first my Insta family to come for this whole program. So it's happening on the 27th and 28th. It's 4,999 rupees at the Feathers Hotel in Chennai. So if by any chance you've been experiencing any kind of pain in any of your relationships, where you've been feeling like, you know, I'd love to bring the spark back, or I'd love to fight better, or I think these cold wars are not working for me, or I wish there was a way to communicate to get the man to understand what I have to say, or I wish I knew how to influence him, or I wish I knew how to attract him, any of those, I would love to absolutely take you through a 2 days of beautiful program. All right. Is it not online? Unfortunately, not online. It is going to be happening offline on the 27th and 28th of April for now. Okay. If it ever gets online, I will 100% let you know. But of course, the online experience can never match an offline experience, for those of you who know what I mean. Yes. Fabulous. All right. So let's get started. Let's look for some coming for Love Bubble. Oh, welcome, Diksha. So happy to have you here. So happy to have you there and here, darling. I'd like to fight better for women only. Happier women. Ma'am, I'm so confused as a life coach whether to write a book or take seminars or webinars or post on Instagram. Can you please guide? So each one of these things that you're mentioning has its own purpose. So it all depends on what's your purpose, okay? You have to look at, so when you write a book, it is to gain authority in a topic. So if you want to become an expert in any topic, if you want the industry or the world to listen to you, whenever you say you're an author, author has more prestige, right? So a book gives you credibility. It's a beautiful, exactly what certifications give you. So certifications, books, these are all to build authority and to build credibility. So if you're looking for credibility, great idea to write a book. Now, seminars and webinars are your funnel. This is where you deliver and sell so that you can make money. So if money making is your agenda, or you want to run it like a business, then seminars and webinars need to happen, because that's where you will take the person from level 1 to level 2 to level 3 to level 4, and all of that will give you returns. So seminars and webinars are for money making. Posts on Instagram is for brand building. Your personal brand needs to get built, right? People need to get to know you. When they get to know you, they need to fall in love with you, or they need to like you. And if they know you and like you, the chances are they'll start to trust you. And the day they start to trust you, then they don't mind taking out their credit card and paying you for whatever it is that you are desiring to give them. So can you see how each one is a different reason? So yes, if you want to write a book, credibility. Seminars, webinars, money. And Instagram, building your personal brand. So now you can see which one you need to do first, which one you need to do later. But they all are very, very different. It's like somebody asking me, I'm starting a business. Should I be buying the raw material? Should I be selling the raw material? Should I be doing accounts? Or should I be marketing? Or should I be doing sales? Or should I be doing production? They all need to happen for the business to run. They are not individual. They are all needing to happen for the entire umbrella business to happen. Got it? Perfect. All right. Let's go for the next one. Waiting for Love Bubble. So sweet. What to do when people around you are not including you in their plans and making you feel left out? So Yamini, the first question you need to ask yourself is why? Okay? One could be you are not around the right people. Sometimes when we are around some people who don't make us feel included is because you're hanging out with people who don't value you. If you're not being valued there, you need to start to look at creating a new group for yourself. A group that values you, a group that you value. Okay? Another reason could be that you've not invested enough in them. When they started all of this group planning, something may have happened and you may not have invested in the group. So it's not always that the group is leaving you out. Sometimes we ourselves haven't contributed to the level that we need to, and because of that, you could be feeling like that. Yeah. Thirdly, remember, group energy is always requiring one person where you need to get close to one person in the group for a one-to-one. So when you don't get included, who can you call and keep accountable ki yaar mujhe kyun nahi bulaya? Because if you are friendly with the whole group, you're actually not friendly with anyone. Your job is to get friendly with one person inside the group. So you need to start investing in that one person who then, when you're not invited and she's invited, will make sure that you also get invited. Okay? So if I am, you know, having a friend and she's not invited somewhere, I will tell that person, hey, please invite her also. Na, she's very close to me. Fir wo baad mein gussa khati hai. Even if I'm saying it like that, I will make sure she gets invited. Right or no? So your job is to get friendly with one person. Sometimes when you're friendly with the whole group, you're actually not friendly with anyone. So these are all group dynamics that I'd like you to start to understand. And if still you feel not included, you just need a new group, meri jaan. You know, so many times it happens, it ruins our self-esteem, it damages us even though we didn't do anything. You know, some people are the kind who tend to create groupism within groups. And if that is happening by any chance, then it just could be that you're getting left out because you don't have a common enemy like they have. Okay? Sushmita, how to handle a husband who doesn't even care and treats you as a liability? Come for love bubble, let me help you. Why you want a 5-minute answer when I'm willing to give you a 2-day answer? Hai na? Anyways, you know what? If someone just doesn't care, then you have to know why are you there. Because you're not there for the care, then why are you there? Are you there for the children? Are you there for the money? Are you there for the safety? Are you there for the security? Are you there for what reason are you there? Because he's made it very clear to you, he doesn't want you. Now you have to make up your mind, and to such women I normally say, take 2 years, become supremely independent and powerful, and at that point either the man will change and start to value you, or it will be time for you to find a new man. Okay? If someone is treating you like a liability, what are we going to do? Beg him to love us? No na, that is not how we want love any which ways. Wo wale love ka koi meaning bhi nahi hoega. True or not? Anju. Ma'am, my question is, so this year, law of attraction is working, whatever I like, but now I'm suddenly worried it won't work and I'm self-sabotaging. How to shift my mindset again to how to make it not? So Anju, I'm guessing your question is that you're starting to get worried that it will not work. And there may be few things that may get delayed to come, which may make you feel like it's not working. Okay. So a lot of times what happens is, my suggestion is, shift your mindset to this, that all that is coming to me, that's fabulous, and all that is not, it's only because God wants to give me a better version of it. So it's taking a little longer. So what that does is it helps us manage that divine delay that sometimes can happen between what we want to attract. You're already doing a fabulous job. For me, my entire basis of law of attraction is the vibration that you are carrying. When you are high vibrating, you will manifest. It's like gravity. There is no doubt about it. And every now and then, God will test you. When he tests you, do you go away from law of attraction, or do you still stick to the thought that no, it's going to work. Maybe it just didn't work this time, but I will make this work. And when the test happens and you pass the test, he'll give you double. Okay. So your job is never to read the one chapter of the book. You have to go to the end of the book. And the end of the book is that it'll always work out. Okay. But we sometimes don't have the eyes or the perspective to see it till the end. So we look at 2 chapters and we say, you know what? It stopped working. No, it's not stopped working. It is only divine delay. And divine delay is not ever to punish you, but to prepare you to get ready to receive something so amazing. So instead of getting worried that it won't work, shift your energy to there can be a delay. It's not 100% that everything will come according to my timeline, but that everything will come, that I believe in. Okay? Vidhi, I'm so scared to take the first step to start content creation. What to do? Vidhi, my suggestion to you would be, content creation is the easiest part for a coach these days, and I'll tell you why. If you just spend 3 months on YouTube, googling and searching and analyzing and understanding all of the material in your topic, in less than 3 months, I call it my 30-90 rule. Every single day, spend 30 minutes for the next 90 days. Or if you're in a rush, you can do 90 minutes a day for the next 30 days. So 30 minutes for the next 90 days or 90 minutes for the next 30 days. Spend on YouTube and watch yourself becoming a pro at the topic that you're talking about. Okay. Now what that will do for you is it will start to inspire you. When we watch one person, we copy. When we watch 50 people, it's called research. So I want you to research your topic and find out from every possible version of it, what is everyone saying about it, okay? That will put you in inspiration. So it will inspire you, and then what will happen is your own ideas will start to get formed. A time will come where you would have taken a little bit from here, a little bit from here, a little bit of from here, and when you did your own mixy, it becomes your own formula. And at that time, you put a name to your formula, and that's how you do content creation. So there's nothing to get scared about content creation, because content is one thing that is too much right now in the world. There is more content on YouTube that even than what you can consume. Would you agree or not? So we have crossed the information age. Today we live in a world where information is a touch of a button. It's no longer the information age. Information is understood that it's there. It's the application of that information that we have to teach. So you're never teaching content. You're teaching how to understand that content and how to apply that content. So one thing I'm never worried about is content, because there's more than enough. There's too much content. So don't be scared about content creation, Meri Jaan. Every day sit in your meditation. Let your creative genius come to you. See if you can sit at the same time every day. You will start to get ideas. The house I'm in right now, if you want to just, I'll just show you. So if you can see that there is a glass box, that's my lift. And if you can see, there's a glass box that I keep walking around. Okay. So I'll keep walking. I get up early in the morning at about 4 o'clock. From 4 to 6, I'll be chakkar. And as I'm taking those chakkars, I will keep getting all my fabulous ideas. I'll have a paper here on this table. And as I'm walking, the ideas will keep coming. I'll keep noting. So please know that once you get inspired and you've put in a lot of extra content on your topic, your own content starts to come out, okay? And that's how you create content. And it's such a fun process. Of all the things that I do, content creation is one of my favorite things to do, simply because it puts me in the zone, in the flow, in the alignment. I feel like one with universe and I can hear God whispering. So it's really fun. So once you start to do all of that, you will really enjoy the process. Brewing life. How do we decide the audience we should target for life coaching? Wow, today looks like a coaching session happening. I'm seeming to be answering a lot more coaching questions. Interesting. I like that. How do we decide the audience we should target? So I love to look at who is it that I love helping. Now, how do I know who it is I love helping? People whose pain I understand. So if you understand a certain section's pain, so some of us, I like to always say, our mess becomes our message. What does that mean? Let's say somebody in my family has gone through cancer. If somebody in my family has gone through cancer, what do I understand about cancer? A lot more than somebody who doesn't. So maybe that can be a topic. How to help the caregivers of cancer patients becomes a topic. Maybe I got 100 on 100 in 12th boards in maths. Okay, perfect. I can start to take tuitions because I know exactly how to study maths for 12th grade. Okay, I got married at the age of 18, lost my identity, did not have an education, was very, very, upset with where I had gotten stuck. So my job was to help women like me. So I just made a list of all my pain points. I felt lonely, I felt isolated, I felt misunderstood, I felt hurt, I felt angry, I felt I had a lot of potential but nothing to do, I felt ungrateful. Whatever I felt, I made a whole list of and I said, I'm going to help women in all of these topics. So the best way to find your topic is to look at what in your life has happened that is unique to you, that can be taught to someone else and it will help someone in the process, because what you experience, you went through it alone, but others don't have to go through it alone. I always say this, I got married, I got pregnant at the age of 19. I went through that whole period so lonely that I don't ever want a woman to be lonely again, which is why I have such a strong sisterhood. If you're a part of my sisterhood, make some noise in the chat box, because I love my sisterhoods, goddesses, ladies, because I can tell you now, the one thing my sisters won't feel is lonely. They know that there is a whole group of women behind them, helping them, supporting them, being there for them. Recently, I had a lady in Mumbai who was in and out of hospital for her father, and this other friend of hers moved in with her for that week. And I was like, wow, such a lovely support system they are giving to each other. I feel so proud when I hear stories like this. Sakshi 811, how to deal with trust issues with a husband that is cheating on you? Sakshi, trust is something that needs to be earned back if the man is cheating, okay? So it's not your job to trust him. It is his job to make you trust him. And if you are not able to trust him, then it's not your problem, because he hasn't done enough. So we have a lovely teacher called Esther Perel. For those of you who ever get into trouble with this whole infidelity thing, she's a lovely person to follow, because she has video pe video pe video on what all needs to be done. And one of the things I say is the man needs to first acknowledge that he did wrong. A lot of times the man is not even acknowledging. How can the woman heal? The woman wants to start healing process without even him acknowledging. It's not going to happen. You're going to be like a tadapti fish. Because you know what? It's the biggest betrayal for a woman is that. So because it's the biggest betrayal, I feel like the first thing he has to do is he has to first acknowledge that he's done something wrong. Then he has to become someone who starts to support and help you to recover from the damage that he's done. Okay, so he has to pick up that topic. He has to put it on rest. He has to keep bringing it up. He has to apologize, and he has to spend at least 3 to 6 months working really hard on you trusting him again. He needs to make you believe once again that you can recreate. Now, Esther Perel says something very beautiful. She says, we are going to have many relationships in this lifetime, and some of them are going to be with the same person. So when your spouse actually cheats on you, the real truth is that that relationship that you had before the cheating has died. Okay, so you're going through a grieving process of death of that relationship that was yours. So there is a part of you that has died. Now, how hurtful will that be? Extreme, right? But the truth is, you can restart that whole relationship once again with new energy, a more deeper deeper coming back together can happen, and the cheating can actually lead to the both of you having a even more fabulous relationship. Is that true, Pooja? I am telling you, it's possible. It is possible if the two people in the relationship, the one who cheated and the one who got cheated, are mature about it. Okay? There's a lot of things you need to do. Can you recover from an accident? Yes, you can. But you need the right doctor. You may need the right surgery. You may need to do the right things for you to recover. So recovery is possible. What is not possible is that you can't take the onus of trust. How can I trust him again? We say that, right? It's not your job. It's his job to make you trust. Now, is trust 100% important in a relationship? It all depends. What are you in the relationship for? A lot of Indian women are in the relationship for the house, for the children, for the sake of the marriage, for the economics, for the money. If all of those are your reasons, then guess what? The trust breaking does not break the marriage. Okay. Now, I want you to become so strong, so powerful that you only be in this relationship for a good partner. And when you're only in this relationship for a good partner, then he will need to become a good partner to keep you. If he knows that you are in this relationship for other reasons, okay, then the chances of his loyalty are not too much, because he knows you will tolerate it or you will compromise, you will complain, you will nag, you will ruin your personality. But guess one of the things that you will not do? You're not going to leave, because you're there for more than just trust. Trust is the base foundational pillar of a relationship, and too many women land up staying, and there's nothing wrong with that till the time they are willing to admit it, that I'm not just here for love and trust and commitment. I'm here for the economics of marriage. And earlier on, marriage used to be an economic exchange. It has only turned into love exchange in the last 50 years. Till 50 years ago, this was an economic contract that we used to sign. Now we want love. And can I tell you where the future generation is going? The future generation is not even in love. They are talking about, he's good, but he's not good enough. He's good, but I'm looking for something even better. So earlier on, even a bad marriage we used to compromise with. Today, even a good marriage feels like, but now it's starting to get boring. So can you see the expectations of society are becoming so huge from that one person that it's becoming harder and harder. So if your husband is in any form cheating, I want you to know this, that you need to sit down with him and let him know that it's going to be his role to gain back that trust that he broke. Okay? So it's not your, you know, what do you call that, cross to carry. Life coach Siva Ranjini. Hi Pooja, my question is, what is the first step to changing our vibration and energy? Gratitude, gratitude, gratitude. If you really want to work with your vibration and energy, you need to get into the mode of gratitude. The more gratitude you do, the more your vibration will change. The easiest, simplest way, 5 gratitudes every day, every day, every day. On bad days, 10. On worst days, 50. You start doing this, you will see a complete change of you going from victim energy to manifestation energy to what I call channel energy. Channel energy is when you think it and it happens, and you think it and it happens, and it's like you yourself are like, what's happening? Why is so much, like, you've entered the miracle zone and you're like in shock. Shruti Agarwal. I am not able to set boundaries with my husband because I am not able to communicate with him. I am scared of his anger. What to do? So Shruti, the thing about boundaries is that we can only set boundaries with people who are equal to us or lesser than us. We can't set boundaries with people in hierarchy higher than us. Now, from your conversation, because you're saying I'm scared of him, it's not feeling like an equal relationship. It's feeling like a he's higher, you're lesser. Till the time he's higher, you're lesser, your job is to treat him like your boss, which means you can request. We cannot go tell our boss, this is my boundary. Because you can't set boundaries with people higher than you. They have the ability to chuck you out. Correct or no? So therefore, that becomes very, very hard. So you have to start to make a plan around how can you do things where your request will be heard. So in my Love Bubble course, I'm going to be showing women 10 different ways of conversing with your spouse or your partner or your boyfriend or your whoever you're with, having the ability to make that influence that we as women need to have over our men for a better life, right? So I have so many different ways that I would love to help you, because till the time you're going to be scared of his anger, you're going to become very timid, and you know, we start to play small and your energy becomes very shrinked, and so instead of you blossoming as a flower, you are shutting down your complete energy, and that's not a great place to be in life. So I'd love to help you, my sweetheart. Join some program of mine, and if you can come for the Love Bubble, come for the Love Bubble. If you can't come for the Love Bubble, at least come till Awakening, so that I can spend 4 weeks with you truly showing you how we women can expand our aura, awaken our own goddess to truly become powerful in our own energy. Okay? and how to make those requests, because you're not going to be able to set boundaries yet. But spend the next 1 or 2 years expanding your aura enough that a time comes you can. You know, I remember when I was early in my marriage, anytime Puneet and I would have a fight, I would say, I'm going to leave. This is not working for me. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And he never really believed any of those threats, because the truth was I wasn't going to go anywhere. So can you see, I had no power. I was trying to be powerful without any power. Right? First few times he was like, please, 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 please don't leave. Then he eventually realized, tu kahin bhi nahi ja rahi. And then my whole trick of I'm going to leave, he said, actually, tu ja. So can you see how when people who throw artificial threats can't do much. Today he says, Pooja, if you actually said you're going to leave, you'll actually leave. So, you know, we all have to gain that power. And the beauty of having power in a woman's life is you don't have to use it. It's like the Ramban, you know. Once you have the Brahmastra sitting with you, everyone is scared of you. Like the other day I was talking to someone, I can't remember who, and they said something so beautiful. They said, actually the nuclear weapon is a way of buying peace, not war. Because every country that has a nuclear weapon puts all other countries to think 100 times before they approach a nuclear weapon country. I don't know right now if that is even true, because the way wars are happening across our world, but so every country wants to own a nuclear weapon so that they don't have to ever use it. Did you see what I meant? We women need to get our power so that we never have to use it. When you become powerful enough, and that's what I need to happen with you. God bless you, Meri Jaan. I'm praying for you. All right. So boundary setting may not be an option, but definitely requests are. And learn to request better. There are ways that women can request men where men will melt. So your job is more to melt him than to make him angry. Now let's see, how can we melt him? What are the things he gets melted on? All of those conversations I would love to have deeply with you. Love bubble ke liye aaja meri jaan. Vandana, my husband drinks a lot. His father also drinks a lot. So my husband doesn't find it wrong. And he also says he is stressed. Please suggest. So Vandana, it all depends on what is a lot. If he can still operate his normal life, then different people have different connection with alcohol. Okay. And if he's operating, he's able to provide, he's able to be there for you, he's able to be there for the children. Okay. If you feel like he's reached a place where the drinking a lot is so much that he's not able to wake up in the morning, he's getting abusive in the evening, and all of the wrong things are starting to happen, then it's an addiction. Addiction means he will need professional help. If it is not an addiction, the more you're going to talk about his drinking, the more he's going to go away from you. So you need to come up with a plan around what is a lot of drinking. So I tell a lot of women, don't become the mother. You know, when we become the mother, one of the things we land up doing is all the time we are nagging that person with just that one thing. He's an adult. Let him make his own decisions. Maybe this is the normal in his house. Now, I have no idea what we are talking about here. So I'm just guiding you that if that drinking a lot is a lot for you, but it's actually not a lot. One drink, two drink, three drinks. Okay. Okay. Every day he's having three drinks. But he can still operate normally in the rest of his life. Don't worry too much about it. If you're feeling like, no, it's turning into an addiction and now everything else is getting compromised because of it, then you have something to worry about. Then you may need to involve other people. Maybe his parents, especially if his father drinks a lot, then you have to tell his father and him both together, sit down with the mother and say, look, what is happening in our house? Maybe you'll need to involve your parents. Maybe you need to involve his friends. You will have to ask for help. किसी की शायद सुन ले या ना सुने, इवेंचुअली अंदर से अपने जागे, कांट से, दीज आर ऑल वेरी डिफिकल्ट. सो व्हाई डज समवन ड्रिंक? लेट्स फर्स्ट गो इनटू दैट अ लिटिल बिट. ओके, नाउ ऑल ऑफ अस हैव वैल्यू सिस्टम्स. ओके, एंड वी हैव अ सर्टन एक्सपेक्टेशन फ्रॉम आवरसेल्व्स. फॉर मेन स्पेशली, इफ दे हैवंट लिव्ड अप टू देयर हाईएस्ट पोटेंशियल, इफ दे हैव नॉट बिकम हु दे थॉट दैट दे कुड हैव बीन, देयर इज अ लॉट ऑफ सैडनेस इनसाइड ऑफ देम. And to numb that pain is why they get addicted to things. So you'll normally see unsuccessful men getting more addicted than successful men. Because unsuccessful men don't get their high from life, they get their high from all of these things. Now, if you can encourage him to get his high from the right things, this addiction will automatically go off. So I remember watching this video of Dr. Abdul Kalam where he said, when he goes into an office, they ask him, when you go in an office, how is it that in under 3 months you can make people like 10 times more efficient than what they were before you come in? He's like, I don't even speak about the negatives. If you bring a person to me who smokes, the one thing I will not speak to him about is smoking. I'll speak to him about everything. I'll find out all of his highest values. I'll put him back on track. I will make him such an efficient, amazing person in life that smoking will leave him automatically, because the reason for what he was smoking will no longer exist. Smoking, drinking, all of these are symptoms. Symptoms of numbing whatever it is you need to numb. And for your husband, it looks like it's stress. Right? So if instead of feeling stressed, he can start to find joy in his work, can you see how that can shift everything? Now, of course, for a wife to make all of this happen, I think that's very, very hard, very, very difficult. You may need external help, sweetheart, to get him to make the changes required. Richa, my question is how to get proper supporting system to run like maids. So Richa, I have a formula around that which I call the zebra horse formula, which is, first you have to look for all of these people. You can get them through agencies, you can tell your friends, you can tell your friends' drivers, people who are resourceful will send you the right people or the people. And then you have to train them to make them right. So how do you do training? You always try your level best to first show them what you want done. Okay, so if you can show them exactly how you want something done, let's say you like your table laid a certain way, day one you show it to them, day two you stand there and make them do it. So in front of you, you need them to do it, so you are going to supervise as they do it. Day three, they will do it on their own and then come call you to show you whether it's correct or not. And from day four, they are now trained to put the table the way you like it. Now let's say in this day one, day two, day three, they are not able to understand your instructions, and on day two also they forget to put the spoon and kanta. On day three they have forgotten to keep the napkin. They are not able to get the training right. Then you know they are not horses, they are zebras, and zebras can't be trained. Okay, so I have this very clear this thing that whenever I hire a zebra, my personality starts to get spoiled because I have a certain expectation that they are just not able to meet. So you know that zebras can't work for you. Zebras will do it their way only. Horses get trained. And if you become excellent at training, in the beginning, lot of effort, eventually everything effortless. Lot of effort becomes effortless. Okay? That's how you want to operate as far as getting supporting systems are concerned. Can a parentless divorced woman live happily without any support system? Sushmita, it all depends on the woman. Okay, it does not depend on if she believes she can. She can. She can create a group of friends for, I mean, I have aunts who've lost their spouse, who don't have parents, who are living a very happy life. She wakes up in the morning, she's exercising, she spends a lot of her time and energy looking after her health, then she contributes to society, then in the evening she goes for cards, at night she has her own. So she has a full solid routine where she has managed to get people to be a part of her life in parts rather than having anybody full time. So can people manage a life with part-time people in their life? I think so, yes. It's something that needs to be worked upon. Maybe at some point this part-timeness will feel hollow and somebody may want a full-time. Some people don't want a full-time. They prefer their part-time relationships itself because they love the variety of their life. So I don't know if there is one single answer. It all depends on what you need or want. Like I always tell my husband, you will need to be married at all times. You're just the kind of person who needs family. He's a very family kind of a guy. While I am not that family, I'm very family oriented. I'm very husband oriented, but I feel like the way me or my dad are made, we are a little more independent in our energy and very capable of not requiring that dependence. So it's the personality type that that decides this. It's not really the it's not a one fit answer for everybody. Okay, let's go right to the bottom. Can you repeat the name of the coach? Esther Perel. I like it. Some people are trollers. Just ignore them. Don't bother too much. Ma'am, can you at some point start to prepare a course for mom-in-laws and son-in-laws? I like that. 100% I'm going to. I promise. Okay? In the next 1 year, I have full plans of doing a daughter-in-law orientation program. I would love to have all of that happen. All right. I can't decide why I'm not able to stay consistent with my career, my workouts, not able to decide what I need to work on. So Deepika, anytime in life you're having consistency issues, you need to start to look at how strong is your why. A lot of times when our why is not strong enough, it's very hard for us to do things. So start asking yourself, why do I do this? Okay. And every day write out a letter to yourself, reminding yourself the importance of that activity. In a month or so, you will start to see a different kind of relationship you developing with that particular activity, and you'll start to find it easier to do that activity rather than procrastinate, because it'll come into your energy. So for me, anytime when I'm not doing something and I'm going on saying I want to do it, I know it's a should. It's not a must, it's a should. Now, should things when they are hard don't happen. Okay, it's a wish, it's a desire. Because it's so hard, anytime you'll try to do it, it won't happen, because your why is not strong enough while the activity is very strong. We need to reverse it. We need to make our why super strong, and so the activity then starts to seem, you know, valuable to do. That's where we need to go. So anything that we attach pain to will eventually go away from our life. Anything that we attach pleasure to will come into our life. So I love swimming every morning, but I find the water very cold. So earlier on, every time I'll touch the water, I'll be like, ay hai, baal dhone padenge, tarada, tarada, tarada. And immediately my monkey mind will take me away from wanting to swim. Now what I did was I started to have 5 clear sentences that I will say whenever I will touch that water. So while my monkey mind will be jumping and saying, horrible, baal dhone padenge, thanda hai, hai, mood nahi kar raha, body pain kar rahi hai, da 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 da. There's another side of me that will be saying, God, water is so heavenly. As I enter it, all of my toxicity gets released. This is heaven. And I will walk through that water and say, you know, in cities, people don't have water. And here I have my own swimming pool. And I will build that whole thing up so much in my head that literally an hour will go off in the pool and I will not feel like coming out, because I've brainwashed myself to just fall in love with the experience of my swimming. My body craves, like in the morning when I'll come out of the room and I'll see the pool, it'll be like, you know, I don't even feel like finishing my walk. I just want to jump into the pool. So I have trained my brain. Now, when you train your brain to not connect things to pain and connect them to pleasure, you have to, in the beginning, act as if. A lot of people like to call it fake it as you make it. I like to just say act as if you love it. Act as if you're excited about doing it. But if you, most of us want to develop new habits, but we attach pain to it. So what we'll do is, hey, I want to read that book. But book reading is so hard. Pata hai, main toh so hi jaati hun jaise hi book kholti hun. You say all of those things, there's no way you're going to be able to build a great relationship with the habit of book reading. You need to fall in love with that habit. And you need to first do it inside your mind before you can do it in reality. Okay, so see if you can work with any of these concepts. Ashna, was feeling so low sometime back. Now after listening to you, I'm feeling so much better. Oh, so happy. Gunjan, is it okay to not get married? Gunjan, let's ask this question. Why do we get married? We get married because earlier on, it was all about being protected and being provided for. Today, women are fully capable of protecting themselves also and providing for themselves also. So why should we get married? The only reason we should now get married is because someone else can take our life to a better level, which means being with him, sharing my life with this person gives me joy. It makes my life better. I make his life better. He makes my life better. Now, when you get into those kind of relationships, those relationships, marriages, partnerships are great. But 90% of the time these days, what's happening is the system of patriarchy hasn't changed yet. So the woman is expected to do everything. So the role of the woman is to do the sacrifice, the compromise, the toleration, and get no appreciation for any of that. She doesn't know why. She doesn't know why she needs to get married. And the truth is, she doesn't need to get married if it's going to be a compromise and tolerating and adjusting, and those are going to be the key words of a marriage. These words were okay for our mother-in-laws and grandmothers and mothers. These are not okay for us. Ours will be the last generation using these words to describe a marriage. I remember when I was getting married, somebody said the first year is your year where your dreams will shatter. And I was like, whoa, that's a really horrible explanation for someone who's getting married. But can I tell you, my first year literally was that. It was a year where all my dreams literally shattered in front of my eyes and I had to rebuild my life from scratch. So for a lot of us here now, we really don't know why we're getting married, because men are not playing that role so fabulously. The chase is wonderful. The men do a fabulous job of the chase. To get you, they'll do anything. After they get you, they don't do anything. To get you, they'll do anything. After they get you, they don't want to do anything. How is that going to work? Right? So I feel like we are going through a gap in our system where the current system is not working for us anymore and the new systems haven't gotten created. So we are on a bridge. And a lot of women are becoming extremely independent because they can't see their future with the quality of men that are right now in the world. I think we as mothers, especially mothers of boys, me and many of you in this room maybe, need to do a better job of raising the boys. The boys need to understand that, you know what? I remember my mother-in-law telling my husband this, that she's left everything and come. So your job is to really, you know, be there for her because she's left everything and come. And I think we as mothers have to drill this into our boys that you need to do more than just protect and provide, baby, because that she's now very capable of. Unless you can be a complete partner to her, be there, understand her emotions, and you know, let her feminine divine really come into the energy of your relationship, that's when she will value you. If her feminine divine has to be shut down and she herself has to play a masculine role, then masculine and masculine is not going to have any love. If women are now today, it's expected from the woman to work also, to run the house also, to have the babies also. She's basically playing all of the roles. So fir uska kya kaam hai? This morning I was watching a video that spoke about 10 women on the road were asked that, do women need men anymore? And can you imagine, all 10 said no. That's such a sad thing. I don't agree with it at all. I think women and men were made for each other, and that we can have the most fabulous relationship if we just create a new way of coming together. The current marriage system is not serving us, especially in India. I think we need to create a new system where we come in as two equals rather than the up down that is happening. Banerjee Madhumita, ma'am, I'm not getting a job and I'm really depressed. How to keep myself motivated in this situation? So Madhumita, you need to start to visualize every day receiving the best job possible. You need to change your whole energy and your vibration if you really want to attract a lovely job. With this energy, you're not going to be able to get the job that you want. So you need to become so much more positive. Now, one of the ways to become positive while you're waiting for a job is to become a learner seeker. So see, is there anything from your previous job that you've realized that you could do, learn, or enhance in your skill sets for you to get a better job? All of your old job has given you so much feedback on who you need to be. So think of what was it that you can do better now. Go learn that. And you know what? Learning gives us confidence. And then when we apply it our skill set and our competency gets better. And confidence competency loop is what helps us get jobs. So you need to keep improving your competency. That will help you improve your confidence. And that's what's going to get you a job. So see if you can shift your energy, because depression is going to take jobs. Jobs will get repelled by you. Instead of you attracting them, वो होते होते नहीं होएगा, होते होते नहीं होएगा, because आपकी energy is not of receiving. How to Ratna Bojak? How to love yourself when you get a lot of hate from your surrounding? Ratna, in the beginning, people don't believe in us till we don't learn to believe in ourselves. So that's the journey we all need to be on. You know, when I was becoming a life coach in 2010, life coach as a term did not exist in India. When I came back and told people I'm going to get paid for speaking, they all were laughing like, why will anyone pay you for speaking? My husband was willing to pay me to stop speaking. So he couldn't understand that people are going to pay you for speaking. Like, what do you know about life that you think people will want to know your opinion on life? Okay, so why I'm trying to tell you this is that in the beginning, we need to have that belief, because there is something we know or we can see in ourselves that others can't. And we shouldn't even blame them for not being able to see it, because we haven't done anything up until that point in our life for anyone else to believe in us. So love comes from belief. When you believe in yourself, then you can love yourself a lot more. For that, you need to go on a mission greater than yourself. What is it and how is it that you can contribute to the world for them to start to give you something in return? And that exchange helps us raise our self-esteem. I always say you cannot help someone and not have that. You cannot raise someone else's self-esteem and not have your self-esteem go up, right? So see if you can look for ways where you can help others, and then you know what's going to happen? That's going to translate in you feeling better about yourself. So just to fall in love with yourself, not easy, because our deservability demands action. So whether you're going to build your deservability through doing things and becoming consistent for yourself, or doing things and becoming consistent to help and contribute in the world, you will need to take action for you to fall in love with you. And can I tell you something very beautiful? As that love grows, all these people around you who currently hate you or are not, are either going to vanish because your vibration and their vibration won't be matching, or they will raise themselves to be able to match your vibration and come back into your life. Either of the one need to happen, because when you grow, your surroundings do change automatically, because we design our life inside out. So if you want to see someone's exterior, all you need to see, or if you see someone's exterior, you can very easily judge what's happening inside their mindset, because you know what, you're not ever too far away from how you think. So if your thoughts and your life currently is not working out, is because you've become victim somewhere. You've started to believe that others need to change, others need to fix themselves, life needs to change for your life to change, while the truth is you need to work with courage, clarity, consistency. These are the three pillars of change. When you start to develop more courage in your life and you start to walk that path, which takes a lot of courage, you will start to see those same people who were acting like the boulders or the rodas of the road or the sadak, they will move out of the way and you will walk and you will be like, ye kab se, you know, everything will shift. Rupali, how to become more strong and decisive? Take small risks and accomplish them. So Rupali, the more strong and the more decisive you need to become, the more decisions you need to make. Okay, so you need to start to make small decisions. You know how we, kahan jana hai, pata nahi. Kya karna hai, pata nahi. The pata nahi needs to go into the dustbin now, and you need to go, today I want to wear a white shirt and I want to go for Chinese. Okay, every decision, you need to start to make decisions, good, bad, ugly. There has to be a lot of decision making that needs to be done. And you know what? You need to start to notice that actually most of your decisions are working out for you. I'm not saying all your decisions will work out for you, but generally most of our decisions, eventually we know how to make them right. We take decisions, we make them right. We take decisions, we make them right. And you know what? This builds our confidence. Then a time comes where we don't need to have all of the information to make a decision. We can make a decision and say, you know what? We shall see. And that's confidence, right? So to become more strong and more decisive, my suggestion is, I remember reading this lovely quote. Good decisions come from experience and experience comes from bad decisions. I'm going to repeat that. Good decisions come from experience and experience comes from bad decisions. So in life, stop getting scared of wrong decisions. Just start taking a lot of decisions. All right, it's 4:52. I'm going to start to wrap up. Let me go right to the bottom. Shubha, Pooja, please throw some light on menopause phase of women. I don't know enough because I haven't hit mine yet. So when I do, I will definitely speak a lot more in detail about it. But whatever I hear from my friends who are getting all of the hot flushes, the mood swings and everything, I think it's a period of your life that you need to slow down and honor. So I won't be able to medically give you any advice. But what I can say is it's a period of your life. Like, you know how we have PMS 3-4 days before our periods. And what do? That's the winter of your life. Okay. So we have to start to treat menopause as the winter of our life. It's a period to kind of like step back and re-examine the shifts and the changes that are happening, because we are going through too much of hormonal change. And whenever a woman goes through too much hormonal change too fast, the thing is her emotions and her moods take over. Not enough of those good hormones are being produced. For example, dopamine, serotonin, oxytocin, endorphins, all of these go missing. And instead we get filled with cortisol. And cortisol is that particular hormone that actually makes us upset and angry and you know, just doesn't. It's not in our favor. So what can someone do when they know that there is so much of imbalance that they are going through? I always say, start to look for activities that can be done in isolation. So a lot more meditation, a lot more spending time in nature, a lot more looking after your health, a lot more focusing on. For so many years, most of the women who hit menopause have only given. This is one period of your life where you need to take. Okay, you need to take so that you can rest it out, so that when your summer comes back, which means once this menopause is over, you are again back to doing whatever it is that you need to do. So I don't know in which context you wanted to know about menopause, but whatever little information I have, I'm sharing with you. Sonika, but ma'am, when we become more decisive, we are termed as difficult by our own family. Sonika, labels and names are something that we as women have to learn to live with. Because how does the patriarchy control a woman? By shaming her. How do you shame a woman? By labeling her. So what they call stubborn, I call decisive. Okay, so every time they have a term for us, I have another term to counterattack it. So please, next time somebody calls you difficult, please say thank you so much. You know, my clarity and my decision making is my strength, and I'm so happy that I'm able to do those kind of things. You need to start to stand up for yourself, sweetheart. Otherwise everybody will label you with everything. You know, I remember my family used to call me childish because I got married at 18, and at 18 you are childish. I was a child, yeah. So I was very immature, and so these words, immature, childish, these sat like arrows in my heart. Okay, I used to hate it when somebody used to call me these names, because somewhere deep down it was just very annoying, right? And I remember replacing these words and saying, I'm not childish, I'm childlike. And then every time somebody used that word, instead of getting angry and upset and hurt and everything that I used to go through, I'd say, it's okay, you know, it's okay to be childlike. And you're not supposed to be mature yet. You're barely understanding life. And here you are married, you're pregnant, you're with a baby, everything that was happening to me at that point. So people will term you a lot of names. When it doesn't suit them, get ready. They are going to call you stubborn, they are going to call you greedy, they are going to call you difficult, they are going to call you arrogant, they are going to call you whatever they feel like that suits them, because you are no longer convenient. And when we don't remain convenient in other people's stories, we start to create our own life story, then they don't feel too happy about that. True or not? So, you know what, Sonika? I think it's about time you came for my awakening course, where I will teach you how to put a massive smile on your face and go, thank you for letting me know. Thank you so much. Thank you for noticing. Thank you for, and you can't imagine what all things I've thanked for. All right, last 3 minutes. Let's quickly do the picture. And all you need to do is share it in your story. Tell me which was your biggest takeaway from today. What was your biggest learning? What was your biggest takeaway? And for all of you here who are interested in joining the Love Bubble, the link will be in the bio. I will also be putting the details in my story today. So for anybody who is having the courage to come and work on yourself for 2 full days to improve every relationship of your life, let me tell you, I'm going to burst some of the myth bubbles that we are all carrying, and then I'm going to help you create a new bubble of love with the right perspective, so that you can bring in the right people into your bubble and remove all of the toxicity, because bubbles can't tolerate toxicity. Okay? Please pose again. Sure. Loads of love. Thank you so much. I really hope you got something that you're going to use this week and make your life better, and come back every week, every week, every week, every week, and keep making your life better and better and better. Because you know what? If you are like me, a seeker, we need all of this information, because what the old model was is not working for us anymore. And you and me together are creating a new world order, where we need to not go for patriarchy, not go for feminism, but create that whole mutualism, so that we can respect the man of this world and the man can respect the woman of this world. And together, when we will create a life, it's so much more fun, hai na? All right. On that note, love you all. Bye. Ciao.